This is Jenny Rhodes with University of Maryland Extension. I am the Agriculture and Natural Resource Extension Educator. In other words, I am your county ag agent. My job is to bring research-based education to the farmers and producers of the county as well as our community. Throughout this year, we have filmed a number of educational segments about the different stages of farming and farming practices that are involved with growing and harvesting the variety of crops that are grown here on the Eastern Shore. We're producing an agricultural education series called Homegrown, which will air on Queens County Television, Cable, Channel 7. To see more of each story, log on to QACTV.com and search for Homegrown Programs. Your local arm of the University of Maryland College Park and the University of Maryland Eastern Shore is located in Centreville. The University of Maryland Extension Queens County office offers the following educational programs: Agriculture and Natural Resources, 4-H Youth Development, Master Gardeners, Home Horticulture, and Family and Consumer Sciences. To learn more about the educational programs offered by the University of Maryland Extension office here in Queen Anne's County, contact us at 410-758-0166, or we are on the web at www.queenanns.umd.edu. We are here to provide solutions for our community. I want to thank all of you for coming to our annual agronomy day, one of many and one of many more to come. As long as we have regulations, you guys are going to have to come and get certified, unfortunately. So today you're going to get your pesticide recertification, get your nutrient management credit so you can spread your manure and spread your fertilizer.
I want to talk about nitrogen management, adapting. I changed my title last night from adapting in times of high prices to high prices and low prices. I guess it depends on what you're talking about, whether you're talking about the corn or the fertilizer, which is high and which is low prices. And I'm not an economist. I'm a soil fertility specialist. But the question is about tillage, specifically strip tillage, and how you can cut down your fertilizer rate. I haven't done any specific rate studies geared at that, but we just finished a three-year study with poultry litter, mainly looking at runoff. I'll be honest. It was mainly a runoff study. But we were looking at strip till, vertical tillage. Turbo till is the one that's probably most well-known. Conventional till compared to no-till with poultry litter. We do know that any tillage like that increases nitrogen conservation based on it doesn't allow that volatilization.
So somebody saying I farm organically but I'm not certified, or I do things almost completely organic, but I can't afford to buy the grain.
Well, you're talking about like into Acme buying a bag of Dole lettuce that's grown in California, bagged, shipped all the way across the country. How does that really compare to lettuce that you grow in your farm that you pick today, wash it, and you eat it tomorrow?
So the question is, what infrastructure do you have developed on your farm? Did you have trouble developing that infrastructure if you have it? Is it a bother if you don't have it? And where are your markets?
Yeah, I've had a problem with storage of our grain because we're transitioning more grain all the time. We did put up a bin last fall to hold 17,000 bushels.
Storage is a challenge, and particularly with our organic acres growing. And with us growing primarily corn, and we have a fair amount of bushels to store.
Keep asking questions, because certified organic is really well defined, and anybody who is certified organic knows the protocols and the procedures.
The organic industry nationally is really about networking. And sharing information, and you know, we see that here at the table. We see that within the room. We see that within our county. We see that within our state. We see it within our region. We see it nationally.
My name is Dan Pote. I work for USDA's Agricultural Research Service. We're here today to look at a a new prototype we've developed for placing poultry litter under the surface of pastures and other no-till systems. This one we can load litter directly out of a poultry house and take it straight to the field. Poultry litter, of course, has a variable particle size, ranges all the way from small dust particles all the way to larger chunks that may be a foot or more across. But this unit is able to crush those down to a smaller size. It sends the litter then through chutes. Each chute delivers to one of these trencher shanks. The basic mechanism for placing it in the ground is similar to a regular no-till system, where we have a leading coulter to slice the soil, followed by a double disc opener that opens a shallow trench about 2 inches wide by 3 inches deep. The litter then pours into that trench as the unit moves forward, and closing wheels follow behind to close the trench.
I'm Pete Kleinman with the Agricultural Research Service in State College, Pennsylvania. Last year, for instance, at the University of Maryland Eastern Shore Research Farm, we saw an increase in yields from about 101 bushels to the acre with broadcast litter to 140 bushels to the acre with the subsurface placed litter.
I met Francis Breeding at a local farm off Backstar Road the other day. Francis is an ag technician for the Maryland Cooperative Extension Office in Centreville. He also used to be a town commissioner for the town of Queen Anne. With the help of local farmer Bruce Ivins, he showed me how to calibrate a manure spreader.
Bruce Ivins, we're here at the Potter Farm in Centreville, Maryland, and at the moment we were calibrating our manure spreader to comply with our nutrient management plan, so we called the extension office, and Mr. Breeding was kind enough to come out here and help us with this, and we just wanted to make sure that the spreader was putting on the right amount of manure that we wanted to put on to comply with our nutrient management plan. The reason we're putting down 60 pounds of nitrogen anhydrous in the ground is we have to follow, again, our nutrient management program. We have averages on how many bushels of corn we grow per acre. So when we tell them what our averages are on our farms, then they say, okay, well, if you're going to grow 150 or 200 bushels of the acre, then you can use this many tons of chicken manure, 60 or 80 pounds of anhydrous ammonia. It's kind of up to the customer to determine whether they want to use liquid nitrogen or anhydrous. We found that anhydrous stays in the ground better for my application. And we do inject it in the ground so you don't lose any out in the air. The chicken manure is worked in the ground, incorporated, and just like the anhydrous is. It's knifed into the ground so you don't lose any out in the environment.
We're looking at a 16-row corn planter just pulling into the field. Has moved from another field, but because of the size and what we have to do here in the county, we have to be able to fold our equipment up. What he's doing now is just unfolding the equipment and getting ready to plant. So we're checking for seed placement in the soil. So we want to make sure that it's about, what, Chris, an inch and a half?
Yeah, about an inch and a half deep. And we're running 30,000 seeds per acre. Okay. So right now they're going to be about 6.5 inches, every 6.5 inches.
Okay.
So there should be another one right in here.
With me today is Temple Rhodes. He is the number one chief, I guess, in this operation.
Yeah.
He has. We saw a few of the Indians working over there. So this piece of machinery is called vertical tillage. Trade name is called turbo till. Instead of turning the ground over completely and exposing a lot of soil, this only exposes just a little bit of soil. So we'll have much less runoff from a field like this. It's classified as a no-till practice for farmers, and this is called a vertical tillage type machine. Morning. we're back out on the road again. We are out at Chestnut Vale Farm right outside of Centreville near the 4-H Park. And this morning I have with me a young farmer, Chris Rhodes, a recent graduate of the University of Maryland. He has a degree in ag business. And we were out a couple weeks ago filming strip till and filming also the planter that you can see here behind me. We're going to do some close-ups today. Chris is going to walk around the planter and tell us about the various parts and how they work.
This is a vacuum corn planter. There's two different types, a finger pickup and a vacuum. We have a vacuum. The vacuum runs off of hydraulics. It turns a hydraulic pump with an impeller in it that makes a vacuum that's measured in inches. From the vacuum, it comes down a main tube that has little individual vacuum tubes on them, which goes to each unit. So there's 16 units on this corn planter. And the basic thing with the vacuum is there's a cover with a seal, which has a little flicker on it. And there's a seed plate, which has slots in it. This closes onto the meter and creates a vacuum. There's each individual slots in there, which has little holes in it, which pick up the seed. And it has these brushes, a brush in each one, which keeps the disc clean because if dirt and dust collect on it, then the seed won't seed in there and hold. And then that's when you'll have a uneven spacing when your crops come up. You want a real uniform spacing. Depending on your population, we're planting 30,500, so we usually have about a 6.5 to 7 inch spacing. And you want that pretty even.
We're here this afternoon at Stonehouse Flowers, Inc. with Farron Jeter. She has graciously, we invited ourselves, I guess. We asked her if we could come out and look at her operation. So, Farron, tell us a little bit about your operation.
Well, we grow for Bell Nurseries. We're a contract grower for them, and we have 1 acre under roof and a head house where we keep all of the things that help us put things in and put things out. And basically we have two turns of flowers that come in every year, and we grow them to the point where they're in full bloom, and then we ship them back to Bell, and they end up going mostly to the Home Depots around the Mid-Atlantic coast.
Farron said a little bit about Annie's Project. Annie's Project is an 8-week educational class that is put on by the University of Maryland Cooperative Extension. Myself and Shannon Dill, who is the extension educator in Talbot County, we started a class just for farm women called Annie's Project. The objective of Annie's Project, it's designed to empower farm women to manage information systems used in critical decision-making processes. And what it does, it helps to build a local network of farm women. And of course, our target audience is farm women that have a passion for business and involvement. And Farron is certainly one of those ladies. We have, Farron was in our second class, and to date we have educated 45 farm women. Our objective is to cover all the different aspects of risks on a farm. We look at production risk, we look at marketing risk, we look at financial risk, we look at legal risk, and human risk.
Preston Greenwald. I'm a sales representative for Grimmark FS in Sudlersville, Maryland. Right now we're in a field just east of Barkley, Maryland. It's a no-till program for corn. We're applying nitrogen and corn herbicide to control weeds for maximum yields. Irrigator is a 1,650-gallon tank on the back of it, about 40 acres per tank mix at 40 gallons. He's going to apply 130 pounds of liquid nitrogen with a herbicide program. Then they'll come back and side dress depending on their nutrient management program for the amount of nitrogen that is required in this farm.
The other night we had our strawberry twilight meeting. We have that meeting every year here at the Y Research Center, and this is actually about the 15th year we've been having this meeting. We invite people from around the state as well as surrounding states here to the center to see the work that we're doing here at the center on strawberries, and highlight the research, give a little bit of information to the growers that they may not have access to through their own sources. We kind of look at it as more of an informal type of presentation, where not really any formal presentations, but we allow growers kind of to interact face to face with some of our specialists that we have here at the university. So we really like it when we can have that one-on-one interaction with the growers.
I work for the University of Maryland Cooperative Extension. I am the ag agent here in the county. I'm also a poultry grower. So I have been involved. I grew up on a farm, actually stone's throw from here. I've been involved in the poultry industry all my life. I want you to know that poultry is good for the environment. It's good for the people of Queen Anne's County. It's good for the people of the state, and it's good for the people of our nation. So we're here today to celebrate the poultry industry. So please visit everyone and learn a little bit about poultry.
Are you ready?
So this is a brand new operation. They're actually having an open house here today, so we thought, what a great chance for us to come up and show the county about the broiler industry here in the county. So Jack and Robin, tell us a little bit about your operation and how you got started.
Well, we got started about 10 years ago, and we built some chicken houses on our family farm, which is just up the road, and then we decided to expand. My husband was going to come home with us and work on the farm, and we found this beautiful farm, and we put some more poultry houses on the farm, and that was about 5 or 6 years ago. And then while we were doing that, we also did some things for the environment as far as the crepe grasses, and we had a wetlands restoration. And then recently we decided that we were ready to expand, and we decided that we were going to build some new chicken houses. And with our family, we have 3 children, so we're very excited about the houses, and we work together as a family. And I was going to say, I did chickens as a child. And my father had a chicken farm, and he was an agriculture banker, so I got started a long time ago. I wasn't happy about it as a kid, but as an adult, I'm very happy about it.
Since we're talking about planting a field of soybeans, I thought you might want to look and see what the seed looks like. So they're mostly a round to oval shape, and they're certainly all different sizes. We're getting ready to fill up with soybeans. He has indicators inside of his tractor cab that tells him when he runs out of soybeans in each one of these compartments. So he's removing the lids, and then you'll see he'll start the motor, and then he'll start filling up each section. This is a 12-row planter that we're looking at here. And when he gets everything filled, he can plant about 30 acres of the soybeans that he has put into all these boxes. His row spacing from one row to another is 30 inches. This is a female operator of the combine. We have several women in the county that drive the combines in the farm operation. This is a family operation. This is Betsy Ligger driving the combine. Her husband is in the truck, and you see her son Mitchell that just jumped out there, and what they're going to do now is they're going to hook the head to the combine. They have to be very, very careful doing this. So from this crop, they'll be getting the wheat seed that they will sell at the mill. And like I said, that goes to the mills in the north, and they'll be making cookies and pastries and cake flour out of this wheat, and then they'll take the straw that we see them baling, and that'll be sold to the mushroom industry or to the horse industry for bedding. After the wheat was cut, the straw came out of the back of the combine. You can see how it's pretty fluffy. It's 2:30 in the afternoon and still just a little bit wet. So they're waiting for the straw to dry off. This is an issue that farmers face with Mother Nature. So in order to start cutting wheat, harvesting wheat, they have to wait for all the moisture to be out of the grain. So a lot of times we don't get started probably cutting wheat until a lot of times around lunchtime, just waiting for the moisture from the night before. We are here today, July 23rd, at the 11th Annual Maryland Commodity Classic. We have Dr. Arv Grabowskis is going to talk about diseases on the forefront in Maryland grain production. We have our keynote speaker today is going to be Richard Brock, and he is the owner and president of Brock Associates, and he's going to talk about the volatility in the market, in the grain market.
No one knows for sure what's going to happen in this environment, so I think you guys stay somewhat diversified in. I think, you know, I think in an environment like this, and while some of you may say, damn, he's negative and everything, you know, I think these are the most opportune times anybody has in a market. And let me explain one. I had an old professor once told me, he says, just remember, inflation is an awful thing. It makes a lot of people think they're smart who aren't. Okay? If you understand me, all you had to do is own something and it all goes up. You know, in the last 3 years, for the most part, people in this room who own farmland, your net worth went up the same. You know, you didn't gain any relative wealth, okay? Because everybody was going up the same. The Kennedy family made all their wealth in the collapse, okay? That's where all the wealth came in the Kennedy family. It was made in a collapse, being right when everybody else was wrong.
Hi, I'm Courtney Willoughby. I'm the new state FFA treasurer. I also came from a rural. I didn't grow up on a farm, and just because of that, I thought I couldn't join FFA, but as a freshman, I did join just to get the experience, and I competed in various CDEs, which we have plenty of, and I got to meet great new friends that have lasted a lifetime, and I think it's a really good program for kids to get into. I mean, you don't have to live on a farm like people think that it is. It's not all about that. You get the agriculture experience, you learn a lot, and you get to do a lot of hands-on projects, so I think it's a great program for you to get into.
Our farm is 77 acres, and from the start we knew we wanted to be certified organic, and so that was always our goal. But it was a conventional soybean field when we bought it, so it was a 70-acre soybean field with 7 acres of woodlands. Currently we farm about 250 acres of ground total. Most of that is grain, corn, beans, and barley, and cover crops in between there. And our vegetable operation is about 7 acres this year. The markets for us are excellent. You know, we're kind of in between Washington and Baltimore and Philadelphia.
CSA is community-supported agriculture, and what it is customers buy a share of our harvest each year. We try and do different markets so that all our eggs aren't in one basket, so a portion of our harvest will be just for CSA. And in the beginning of the year, like in the first week of February, we open up our farm to sell shares. And shares this year were $428. And the share, the buying starts in February. The harvest of the vegetables starts the third week of May each year. And then it goes for 20 weeks into October.
Seems like every year we have a new customer who, about the end of May, will say, how come I don't have tomatoes yet? Well, traditionally, we get tomatoes last week of June, first week of July, and you know it's kind of the average. And it's like, well, because tomatoes aren't in. Well, in the grocery store, they have local tomatoes. off, you want to consider South Carolina local. There are local tomatoes, but we won't have tomatoes until the 4th of July. And 9 times out of 10, maybe even 99% of the time, that person realizes what they just said, and they're like, you know what? Yeah, I understand that.
We advertise on a website called Local Harvest. I'm not sure if you have you guys heard of that in your travels. It's localharvest.org. Fantastic. You should really check it out. It's throughout. It's nationwide. And all you do if you want a product, like if you want Thanksgiving turkeys, you go to the box and click on your search box, type in Thanksgiving turkeys, type in your zip code, and it'll show you the nearest farms within 100 miles who have Thanksgiving turkeys.
This afternoon, we're going to spend a little time in the 4-H indoor exhibit building, and we're going to look at some of the projects that the kids have entered. So with me, I have Sally Rosenberry, and Sally works at the office with me. She works for the University of Maryland Extension also, and she is the 4-H assistant.
We have approximately 300 children in Queen Anne's County that are in our 4-H. We do everything livestock through clothing, electric, sewing, photography. The baking is a big one. Photography's big. And this year, vegetables were our number one. Gardening was a good year for gardens, evidently. Yeah. Potatoes especially. Yeah. And you are, I believe, our first 4-H'er to reach the Diamond Clover Award, which is the top pinnacle of projects that they've done. You want to tell us about your Diamond Clover project?
Sure. The Diamond Clover Project is kind of like the Eagle Scout level award, and these boards were actually made by an Eagle Scout for his project, and we love them. They're our photo boards. But my project, I'm not quite done. I'm still working on it. I gotta do the paperwork, so it's not official. But I take old t-shirts, and I cut off the sleeves and the collar, and I hem up the bottom and gusset the corners, and I make recyclable t-shirt bags. Yeah, 4-H is one of the only things I'm really like 100% passionate about. I want to do this forever.
Well, last year, I think we gave $700-$900 scholarships to children to be able, to 4-H'ers to be able to go to college. So we still have a huge passion, and we want to see children excel in 4-H.
Hi, I'm Chris Johnston, the Queen Anne's County 4-H agent, and I have two of our 4-H members here that are involved in the Queen Anne's County Fair to tell you a little bit about their projects. I'd like to introduce Luke Saltonfuss, and he'll tell you a little bit about what he's entering here in the fair.
Hi, I'm Luke Saltonfuss. I do a lot of things, but one of them is chickens, and I've got 3 or 4 chickens and a pigeon. I do some indoor taxidermy work, and this year I did some chicken showing, and it turned out pretty well. My pigeon got first, and my chickens got first and second and third.
Tell us a little bit about your beef project.
I started with him at like fall, and it was a lot of work, and he's gotten a lot better, and we won grand champion bread and earns here. So.
Oh. It's really about, it's not about the blue ribbons, but it's about the blue ribbon kids.
Today we're here with Hans Schmidt of Schmidt Farms, and they're harvesting tomatoes today. And Hans, tell us a little bit about your operation. How many acres do you have?
Well, we till about 1,800 acres.
How long does it take you to harvest 150 acres of tomatoes?
On a good day, we can do about 10 to 12 acres a day. A lot of it depends on how much the plant will actually give us a quota to do each day, because they're harvesting in various other parts up in Pennsylvania and New Jersey as well.
All right, well, this is a pick right machine. What happens is this whole unit will ride on the ground, and these two blades are running circular, and they cut the vines, and then the whole vines and the fruit, these gathering chains are turning and pulling in the vines and the fruit. And then the fruit and vines will travel up this conveyor up to the back.
Being the extension educator for Queen Anne's County, my job is to take the research that has done here and then give that research to the farmers, let them know what's going on. So Mark Saltonfuss is the program manager for the crops, for the farm crops here. What we do is we work with the research farms, and we're lucky here in Queen Anne's County, we have our own research farm called the Y Research Education Center, located outside of Queenstown down Carmichael Road. First, we had a combine meeting. We had a gentleman named Marion Comer come from Illinois. Mark had heard him talk at a no-till conference last winter out in the Midwest, and he talked about just little things that he could do with his combine to save himself money. So, and that we saw last year out, we do national corn grower samples where farmers enter the national corn growers contest. Our office has to go out and actually perform these yield, we call them a yield check, to see how many bushels per acre. And we saw some corn being left. And with corn right now at about $5 a bushel, and with the cost that farmers have for inputs, fertilizer, chemicals, all that is very expensive. So we want to make sure, my job is to make sure that the farmers are being as profitable as they can. He is a farmer himself. He didn't like the way his combine was acting. And so he went in and he did some engineering, did some changing, and someone came to him and said, hey, you can patent that. So he patented it. Now he has his own business. So I wanted farmers to be able to see that. He gave them some very practical, just little things that they could do that, you know, wouldn't cost them really much money at all. But the bottom line is to increase profitability. So then in the afternoon, we had a root dig, and Mark and I started doing some research, and really nobody had done a root dig much, I guess, in the Delmarva area. Farmers wanted to know, was it really worth them taking their time to no-till rip? And what they do, they have a ripper that they go in, and what it does, usually about 12 inches, 10 to 12 inches, there's a hard pan that will actually form in the soil. So what they do, it has a shank on it, and it'll usually go down like maybe say 14 inches, and it actually breaks that hard pan. And when it breaks that hard pan, it allows the roots to move down in a soil profile. So once they move down in that soil profile, the better root system we have, certainly the better yield that we're going to have.
On the corner of Lawyers Row and Commerce Street in the heart of Centreville, you'll find folks selling the freshest produce and handmade goods around. They'll be here every Wednesday and Saturday from 9 to 1 through the end of October. So come on out and visit with them.
What you're seeing out here is 30 varieties of pumpkins. Many of these pumpkins are entered by seed companies. We request the seed companies. We ask whatever they'd like to put in. They put those in. They put in about 20 of them. 10 of them we choose, or we try to keep some of the pumpkin varieties running so we can see them year after year. Here at the Y, Mike has got a no spray block in the very back, and you got to see that today. There were no sprays applied there.
Like Brian said, I'm the program manager here, so I had to take care of all the research products that Gail and Brian, Jerry, you know, and put on. So when things don't go right or yields, I kind of take it a little bit personally. So I guess I'm going to try to come up with an excuse of why our pumpkin crop looked a little poor this year. And I think, as far as I can remember, I think this is probably the worst that I've seen it out here. And if you've been here before, I get up and do a little bit of politicking for the use of cover crops, and they do a lot of good things for the soil, help prevent erosion, increase soil moisture infiltration, moderate soil temperatures.
The machine you see over my shoulder is called a combine. A combine is a machine designed to harvest crops when they're mature and the farmer's ready to send them to market. This particular machine is set up to harvest corn today. We're here on the Covington farm right outside of Centreville, and they're harvesting this corn to go to the market. They're sending it to a feed mill that's going to put it in chicken feed. Pointed thing you see on the front, the points separate the rows of corn as it goes through. Each row goes into a separate area of the combine to be harvested. The ears come off, the rest of it goes through to the ground. Once it goes into the machine, the husk is taken off. The ear is shelled. The shelled corn goes into a bin, which is then put into a truck, like the one over here to this side. then the husk and the other refuse goes out the back of the combine. And it works similar to that when they do soybeans, only it's a different type of head on it. It's like a sickle bar like goes on a mower. It cuts the whole thing as you go. Instead of taking each row individually like the corn does. We're the number one corn growing county in the state of Maryland. We're the number one soybean growing county in the state of Maryland.
We hope you have enjoyed this educational program featuring University of Maryland Extension and local farmers and producers. Look for our complete homegrown series on QACTV and on the web.